Welcome to Timucua. I'm Christoph. Somebody recognizes me. Thank you very much. I'm Christoph. I'm the executive director of Timucua Arts Foundation. Benoit would love to be here tonight, but he's out playing trumpet. Keeping a roof over this place. So we appreciate that. So thank you all for being here. Anybody here for the first time?
Yes.
A few? Hey, about half the crowd. That's wonderful. Thank you for being here tonight. So this house, formerly known as, and sometimes still affectionately referred to as the White House, we call it Timucua. And basically, Benoit and Alain built this house 10 years ago because they wanted to invite people in for concerts. They still live here, this is their private home, and we've done 700 concerts with the foundation that they started, so it's pretty amazing. We like to have visual art presented, and we have a very special artist working with us tonight, who I will introduce in just a moment. But I wanted to say, please hang on to your glasses, just housekeeping things. Please hang on to your glasses, just keep one for the whole night. Anything that you brought in tonight, please bring back out. Don't dispose of any food waste in any of the restrooms. The restrooms are on all three floors, just go straight to the back and on your left. In the event of an emergency, there is an emergency exit back into the orchestra left, stage right, orchestra left. But you can also just exit the way that we came. If there is an emergency, don't go up. There's no ladder from the third floor. There's no slide down to the street level. So please just exit the way that you came. Any other housekeeping things? Oh, we survive and thrive thanks to your donations. So if you haven't already donated, we greatly appreciate your donations in the bowl. We also have a membership program. Memberships help keep us going. They're our number one largest source of funding. So please talk to us about becoming a member. You can talk to Wendy, you can talk to me, and we'd love to hear from you after the show. Please silence your cell phones. You are welcome to take pictures or videos, and use the hashtag TimucuaArts if you do. Tag somebody who you think should come. And if you haven't brought anybody to the house, I know Anthony and Claire brought some friends from out of town, so please bring friends next time that you come. And I think that's it for the housekeeping, right? So without further ado, I want to introduce the creator of the incredible visual art that you see all around you. Are these works for sale, by the way?
Yes, they're all for sale.
All
and there are price tags on them, and that's more outside. Smaller, more affordable pieces outside.
So, Micah Aiton, everybody. Did you want to say a few words about your pieces?
Yes, I would love to.
Sure, come on up.
Thanks for coming all tonight. Well, hard to talk to a crowd that you can't really see. I have conferred with Elizabeth before the last few weeks. I asked her what's going to be playing, and I listened to some of her music. And she had one piece online that was called something like Ancient Earth. And the sounds that I listened to made me think of two pieces I already had in my repertoire. And there was that one there, which was actually inspired by the Grand Canyons. And then these two, which are also a reflection of ancient Earth, or Earth in itself. And then I went on ahead and listened some more in preparation for tonight. And as you see, I use a lot of texture, and that texture is a multi-day process. So I was not able to show that to you in these 90 minutes tonight. So I had to prepare this week. And I got this far, so tonight we just put extra paint on it with together with the music, inspired by the music. All of my pieces are for sale, and like I said, they're more outside. I have more in the car. There are also some prints outside, so every price range is covered. What else?
You have an email list. People can join your email list.
Yes. I have a sign-in sheet. If you would like to receive emails for when I do presentations somewhere or show my art, I send out notices for that. And I also do it on Facebook. I would love to get you got your email addresses.
Where are you from?
From Satellite Beach.
That is the Satellite Beach.
Are you insinuating I don't talk right?
And they can talk to her after the show, right? I'm going to stay.
Yeah.
I'm from live here and I live in Missouri. I've lived in Texas. I've lived all over.
Okay, so another round of applause for Mike. To introduce our performer for this evening, Elizabeth Baker has performed here many times. She is a friend, and she's also an extremely adventurous artist and a tireless advocate for contemporary classical music. At our Accidental Music Festival Marathon last year, she brought an entire room full of instruments and just shared them with children and people of all ages, like they could come over and like play a toy piano or a synthesizer or an electric bass or a mandolin. It was really amazing. So she is a tireless advocate for education in music, for contemporary classical music. She's a great arts presenter, great friend and human being, dancer, writer, everything. She's done it all. Is this time out or is this
yes,
movie?
Please.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I'm a little slow on that. You asked for the house things. Did you talk about the ads? No.
Yeah, okay, what else? Yes.
Okay,
very good. Wonderful. Okay, so without further ado, we introduce our artist, Elizabeth Baker.
Thank you. about me dancing on the stage. Chris mentioned, I do a lot of different things, but piano, of course, was my first instrument. And so this is a program of returning to that, and returning to the delicate side of the instrument. So the first piece was an older piece of mine called Firestorm. And the next piece is Dreams by John Cage. It is one of my favorite pieces. I have a little bit of an emotional attachment to the piece. If you know the history of the piece, which I will tell you, and then you can tell your friends, the piece Dreams was written when John Cage was at a crossroads. He was married to a woman, but he had met this beautiful dancer, Merce Cunningham, and he was having some sorts of feelings, and he was older, and so he, of course, wasn't taking these things lightly, and so this piece he wrote, he really wrote for Merce, and I always see it like you have the dream of the person that you would like to be with, and you're kind of going in and coming out of this dream. And then maybe if you're lucky enough, like John Cage and Merce, who were together for the rest of their lives, you wake up from that dream and the dream is a reality. So.
Thank you.
I didn't mean to make that connection, it just happened. Also, he was born on John Cage's birthday, so there's a lot of meta things happening with this. Nathan wrote this piece for me several years ago, and I have said to him that for about the last 3 years or so, I have been afraid of this piece, and I call it the counting piece, because I basically change meter every You guys don't notice it because it's really subtle. And also, it makes many audiences feel very uncomfortable because it's a very sparse piece, very long, and you kind of just have to hang in there with me. And so, I recorded an album recently, and this is the first track off the album, so I don't know if that was a great life choice to put the super sparse 13-minute piece on the first track of the album, but I really do enjoy this piece. It speaks Morton Feldman. I don't know that that was his intention. Nathan and I haven't really talked about his intentions for the piece ever. We are good friends, we do talk, but he's never told me in the like 4+ years I've been playing this at this point, I think 4 years that I've been playing it, what the piece, or why he even named it Sashay. So it's as much of a mystery for you as it is for me. But I hope you guys really enjoy it.
Thank you.
4 years ago. I got really interested in his second suite for piano. The only problem is that the score that exists of it is his own handwritten score, which had a lot of weird eccentricities to it. So I spent about 6 months of my life transcribing by hand from his score into my own handwritten score the entire piece. And I played it before, and it takes about 60 minutes for me to play the whole piece all the way through. So we're not going to do that today. but we are. I am going to play the second movement. And there is a recording of this piece. So pretty much shortly after I finished my handwritten score, I was practicing it and got my first sense of the piece. Because a lot of Eastman stuff, I feel like you have to go back and you learn something new about it. Because first of all, there's no bar lines. And the one time I did play it in public, I had a page turner incident. It is a piece that is so difficult for page turners because there's no measures and it goes by super quickly. And so I had a bunch of foam boards with all of my sheets on them, and I'm going, and the page turner lost her place and kind of quickly tried to move to the next part, and a bunch of posters just fell on my lap. So that's also one of the reasons why we're probably not doing that tonight, because I couldn't find a page turner who was brave enough to take on the task. But with that, there's a lot of fluidity, and ironically, I played another Eastman piece here several months ago. It was Stay On It, and while there is a written score for it, it's really a written interpretation of a live improvisation, which happens a lot with Eastman's music. So I always find new interpretations each time I return to it, because it's not set in stone.
Thank you.
About him, he wrote over 100 pieces for his cats. I'm not going to play the pieces for his cats. but he was considered in many ways to be one of the first minimalists. His work, Visionary Landscapes, was my first introduction to his work. And again, it's a lot of pieces without far lines. I'm a fan of those. I have a very strange perception of time, and some days, like 4/4 just seems really difficult. but 11/8 is always in session. So, with that being said, I really do like things that sort of move in and out and flow and have an organic nature to them. So, Visionary Landscapes. First one doesn't have a name. Some of the movements have names, but nobody had ever told me why that was a thing. All I know is that he wrote over 100 pieces for his cats. So clearly he loved cats and only loved landscapes so much because he only wrote 5 landscapes.
Thank you.
Involves some things, so yeah, there's some special props, shall we say, that are necessary to play this. So I got a grant last year from the county of Pinellas County. And so what I thought would be great to do with taxpayer dollars was to purchase a bunch of vibrators. That they've only been used for musical purposes. It's very important that I say that at every performance. That is the only thing that they have ever been used for. And so I created a piece called Command Voices, and it is based off of the idea that psychotic patients have auditory hallucinations, and they have them obviously so much they have relationships with their auditory hallucinations. And I wanted to create a way for me to have auditory hallucinations with my instrument while creating a construct in which I am no longer the authoritarian. So with all of the pieces that you've heard thus far, I have told the piano what to do, and mostly it has listened to me. There's been some instances where we've had a couple of disagreements, but that's okay. No relationship is perfect. So, there's many vibrators. Not all of them get to the harder ones. They're rogue. Those are the extra batteries, just in case, because I have now become an expert on vibrators. I can tell you all the things you need to know, which ones are the best with battery life, how to get through TSA with 9 vibrators, like lots of wonderful stories, which you can feel free to ask me later. I know everyone's probing question is, where do you procure your vibrators from? There happens to be a handy dandy sex shop next to the Bob Evans where my mom and her church friends go to eat. So it makes it really convenient. So I'll tell just a quick story while I'm getting everything ready over here. So the first time that I went to the sex shop, there's been like 3 times, but the first time that I went to the sex shop, it was like 9 o'clock in the morning, which they open at 8 a.m., so I thought I'd given them enough time to really, you know, get the stock ready and whatnot, and there were a lot of men that came in, and there's a video arcade attached to the sex shop, and they just came in, made no eye contact, and went straight to the video arcade. So I've had the looming philosophical question of whether they were starting their day or ending their day. So it's never been answered fully to me, but you know.
It deserves a concerto.
It really, yeah, it, yeah, you know. I don't know. I only use them for musical purposes again, so I have no idea what people would be doing at 9 a.m. Maybe they went to the Bob Evans, I don't know. So with that being said, this is Command Voices. stuff and not talking. Recently, I played with the vibrators and the piano at a museum, and the Historical Society showed up, which was made of a bunch of little old ladies. And they came up to me and they were like, "Oh my gosh, that was so wonderful. Can we take a photo with you? So what's the difference between all of the, like, are some heavier than others?" And I was like, "Oh yes, they all do the same thing, but just slightly differently." So, and those people that were up in the top rows, they got to see the wireless vibrator is the rogue one. It like flips and does turns and travels in the piano. So, but it also doesn't turn off because it has 10 speeds, so you don't know if it's ever off. So I have one last piece. It is A Room by John Cage, and in deference to Benoit, I'm not going to stick bolts in your piano.
It's not my piano, it's your dad's piano.
I know, but you take such good care of it for her that, you know, I just want to... I need the desk so I can read. It's important. You don't need to read so much for the other piece, because the piano tells you what to do.
Thank you.
player once and burn it into your iPod, and then it's a single-use plastic, and we don't need enough any more of those in the ocean. So I have paper versions where you have a download code and you can stream it on your phone. I also have my toy piano method book, should you wish to learn to play toy piano. And I'd love to speak to you guys now. So, yes, I wrote the world's first toy piano method book. And also, I should probably mention my album is coming out on May 18th. It's called Quadrivium. It's coming out on Arrowcade Music, which is based in LA. And yes, you can see me for details. I think we're in pre-order status.